Lieutenant Senior Grade. Senator Trillanes was Lieutenant Senior Grade. Senator Honasan is DD. Dishonorably discharged.
The gentle lady from Antique, Malabon, Manila, and the Republic has the floor.
Mr. President, I'm certain that the majority leader can only say that of Senator Honasan because they are the best of friends. And he would be the only one to dare say that. Pag iba nagsabi daw, susuntokin ni Greg. Hindi. I assure you, hindi nanununtok ng tao si Greg. Maaring ibang ginagawa niya, pero hindi nanununtok. Simple lang po ang aking katanungan kay kagalang-galang na Kongresistang Raul Daza. Hindi ko po tatanungin ang ating testigo. Just very simple. Article 7 charges that Chief Justice Corona was partial in favor of former President Arroyo, which, as you say in your impeachment complaint, constitutes betrayal of public trust. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Yes. May this representation be enlightened as to the degree of partiality and or bias that will warrant such removal from public office of the Chief Justice. In short, I want to understand the threshold of bias and partiality that a Chief Justice exhibited that would warrant his conviction and convince this court that as far as Article 7 is concerned, he has to be convicted on this count.
Yes. Is the question of the distinguished senator whether the conduct of the Chief Justice amounted to betrayal of trust? Is that the thrust of the question?
I will repeat my question, Mr. Prosecutor. What is the threshold of the degree of bias and or partiality exhibited by the sitting Chief Justice that would warrant him removal from office if and when he is convicted by the impeachment court?
Well, the partiality should be proved by the quantum of evidence that is somewhere between substantial evidence and proof beyond reasonable doubt. It's somewhere between that.
Substantial evidence and proof beyond reasonable doubt.
Somewhere that covers
already the whole spectrum.
No, somewhere between that.
Clear and convincing evidence, perhaps?
The problem is that I've been researching, although not as thoroughly as the distinguished presiding officer, I have not found from my research, either from U.S. authorities or from authorities in the Philippines, which fixes that quantum of evidence necessary to convict in an impeachment trial. It is just that it's somewhere between
I will rephrase my question. I understand your answer. Yeah. However, I completely want to understand.
With the permission
yes,
of the
Mr.
Senator,
presiding officer.
If you study Charles L. Black, Jr., written who is from Yale, and Raoul Berger, who is from Harvard, you'll see there that it would seem that the requirement of the quantum of evidence required this overwhelming preponderance of evidence. Mm-hmm. Although there are indications that clear and convincing evidence is enough. So anyway, that will be a matter that
yes,
will be discussed in due time.
To confess, in all candor, I'm unable and I'm not competent to answer that question with
certainty.
Reliability. I wouldn't want to answer that in a manner that
that
I would
That is fine, Mr. Prosecutor.
Reliable.
We appreciate your candor.
I think if I don't know whether the... I think the question, as I understood it, is asking what is the degree of partiality that will equate into a betrayal of
public trust. Yes.
Was it repeated partiality? One partiality? Two partiality? Three partiality? I think that's the...
The presiding officer is correct in trying to interpret the question which I posed before the prosecutor.
Well, if all the individual acts or actions of the Chief Justice in relation to the TRO that has been the subject of the testimony is proven by sufficient evidence, whatever is the quantum that may be decided by the court, it is our humble submission that that would constitute betrayal of public trust.
Anyway, when the defense turn to present their evidence will come, I assume that they will, a witness from their side will be presented to explain many of these things that are being discussed now. So we will see at that point which one is the more weighty story against the other. Okay?
Yes, let me ask the question insofar as this TRO is concerned with regards to Article 7. What did the Chief Justice manifest or do that he is being charged with betraying public trust through his biased action, opinions, decision, or his so-called partiality?
Yes. Well, as testified to by the witness and from my reading of the dissenting opinions, there were individual acts of the Chief Justice that together, when put together or pieced together, would show that partiality. Among others, one, the fact that because he had the power or authority to decide on the agenda of the court, the two consolidated petitions were agendaed, shall we say, with some speed. I wouldn't want to say indecent speed. Number two, being the Chief Justice, it was within his authority under the internal rules to order that the respondent, Secretary of Justice and the other officers, be first required to comment on the petitions, even if given due course, with the end of view of considering the TRO. Number three, the ponent to which the two petitions were assigned on the issue of TRO recommended a hearing, and yet that recommendation was not heeded. Well, of course, number four, as testified here just this afternoon, on two at least occasions, his spokesperson, Mr. Marquez, misrepresented what really happened within the court, and yet his spokesperson, Mr. Marquez, was never corrected for the interest of the public on those erroneous announcements. And plus, another is the matter of the efficacy of the TRO was assigned to Justice Velasco as ponente. The understanding was that he was going to sit down with Justice Carpio on that clarificatory order. But the Chief Justice on his own broke that and then put on his own version of the clarification of the temporary restraining order and several other acts. Now, one act we submit is not sufficient to prove partiality. But when there are so many acts and all of them show a pattern that would show favoring the former first president, we humbly submit, Madam Senator, that the proof of partiality there is strong. Okay. And that if we submit, this impeachment court agrees with the version of the prosecution based on those facts, even only on this count, because there was betrayal of public trust, the Chief Justice should be removed.
Ang sinasabi ba ninyo, Mr. Prosecutor, na dahil sa kanyang pagmamabilis ng pagbigay ng TRO ay una, minadali, pangalawa ay minaniubra niya ang desisyon nito para paboran ang dating Pangulo.
Tama
so
po
in
yun.
Sum, yung inyong limang minutong paliwanag ay isa sa ilalim sa isang sila, minaniubra bilang Chief Justice ang desisyon, ganun ba ho?
Ganun po. Ito po yung nangyari nang dahil siya sa ilalim ng tinatawag na general rules of the court, may kapangyarihan.
Maski po collegial body ang Supreme Court.
He will get authority and power as Chief Justice to influence the individual justice. And not only that, as I mentioned, gaya po na nasabi ko, talagang lantad, tahasan po, na talagang sa kanyang ganang sarili, pinakialaman pa niya ang gawain ng kapwa magistrado ng Korte Suprema.
Gusto ko pong maintindihan kung paano po niya inimpluwensya ang desisyon ng ibang mga kasamahan niya sa Korte Suprema para po bumoto sang-ayon sa kanyang, ayon sa inyo, pananaw.
Hindi. Kanya nga po ang ginang senador.
Did he bribe, coerce, harass any of the members of the court?
Hindi naman po kailangang takutin o harass ang kapwa magistrado. Alam po naman natin na sa takbo ng buhay, hindi lamang sa Korte Suprema, kundi sa anumang pangkatin sa ilalim ng ating pamahalaan. Pag ang isang namumuno, lalong-lalo na ang punong maestrado, gamitin ang kanyang kapangyarihan, ang kanyang influensya sa kapwa maestrado, hindi na po kailangan takutin. Bulungan lamang, kausapin lamang.
At yun
pero
po ang sinasabi niyong ginawa niya.
Ang mahalaga po hindi po yung cause, kundi yung epekto po yung nandyan . The reality of what happened, how it happened, is not really as important as what really happened.
Thank you, Mr. Prosecutor. Sa takdang panahon po, ay pakikinggan ko naman ng depensa ayon sa sinasabi yung pagmamaniubra ni Chief Justice Corona sa pagbibigay ng TRO in favor of former President Arroyo.
Maraming salamat po, Ginoong Senadora.
Majority Floor Leader.
Finally, Mr. President, the Minority Leader, Senator Alan Cayetano.
Senator Cayetano.
Magandang hapon po, Mr. Senate President, sa ating po mga colleagues. May mga tanong lang po ako to clarify sa ating pong witness, kaya sa ating Justice Secretary. Ma'am, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Your Honor.
Ma'am, are you familiar with
President,
me?
Mr. President, may I just be, the Senator will be asking questions to the witness. In the meantime, may I be just excused to go out for one long minute?
Let us, the gentleman from Taguig will proceed with his questioning, suspend the session for 1 minute.
Thank you, Mr. President. I mean,
there's no TRO. You may for your 1 minute.
Sir.
All right, we go into a suspension in the meantime of the proceedings at the impeachment trial. A parade of senator judges asking a variety of questions from the sole witness so far of the prosecution for Article 7, the Secretary of Justice, Laila De Lima. Questions ranging from what she thinks would be validity of the TRO on the watch list order that was imposed on the former first couple back in 2011, and also questions to the prosecutor, the lead prosecutor in this case, Congressman Daza, as to what would be the degree of partiality that would be seen in the decisions of Chief Justice Corona regarding cases involving former President Arroyo.
Well, you know, we're seeing also a number of senators, former senators, attending the hearings on a day-to-day basis. Let's go to Adele, Attorney Adele, there in the Senate. Adele, again, Secretary De Lima being asked what she thought of this and what was her interpretation of that and et cetera, et cetera. Which brings me back to our question to her yesterday. Na, how would she be testifying? Will she be testifying as an ordinary witness or as an expert witness? Because I think medyo nagbo-border na dun sa expert witness yung mga tanong sa kanya, di ba?
Well, I think obviously she is still just an ordinary witness. When she talks about conclusions of law and she talks about her legal positions, I think that the senators and perhaps also the prosecution and defense are also giving her some leeway because of the fact that she is the Secretary of Justice. And as someone who has also been in the practice, she is quite well known. She's handled a lot of big cases. She was a well-known litigator even before she became the chairperson of Commission on Human Rights and later Secretary of Justice. So I think she's still an ordinary witness, but they allow her to expound a little bit out of courtesy.
Although at the beginning, Senator Miriam Defensor Santiago had already taken the position that the Secretary of Justice would only be considered as an ordinary witness because she was only giving opinions, as Senator Santiago is pointing out, the Secretary of Justice only giving opinions, and she's saying that these were not supposed to count as testimony or evidence.
Well, that's right, but the moment that it seeps into the consciousness of any of the senators.
Talagang may na-introduce na bagong konsepto si Senator Lacson. It has seeped into my consciousness.
But there are a lot of interesting things that came out through the questions of the senators. For example, Senator Lacson was actually making a very good legal point, and this bears on the effectivity of the TRO. He was saying that, in fact, the DOJ did not have the power to issue a watch list order because the Constitution is very clear. Article 3, Section 6 says that if you are going to impair the right to travel, you need a law to do that. And there are only three grounds: public safety, public health, and national security. And so that in fact is one of the issues that is pending before the Supreme Court in the Arroyo versus De Lima case, because the oddly enough, and this is a very ironic situation, it was during GMA's time that she came up with DOJ circular number 41. But now she is the same person who is questioning
the validity,
the constitutionality of DOJ circular number 41.
And put it in another way, or on the reverse side, I remember there was a big debate when Secretary De Lima started using DOJ circular number 41, primarily because, as Senator Lacson pointed out, it was perceived as a tool by the previous administration to, persecute or oppress its perceived enemies. That's exactly what Senator Lacson said. And now, you are now, on the other side of the coin, you're going to use it against her. Siguro, some people will say that's what you call poetic justice or karma. But on the other hand, there's a lot of question na parang sinasabi mo na nga na this is a tool to oppress na ginamit nung dating administration. Bakit mo gagamitin ulit sa mga kalaban mo? Kahit pasabihin mong yung kalaban mo na yon ay nag-oppress sa'yo. Di ba? I think that's the point that Senator Lacson is also trying to make.
Adele,